So first of all, thank you very much to Josh and Alice for throwing this whole thing together. I think it's a fantastic idea. And if you haven't donated, then get on and donate now, because it's a fantastic cause. And with family myself, within the NHS, both my mother and my father are NHS or former NHS professionals, and with lots of friends in the NHS as well, these hardworking guys need as much support as we can possibly give them. So please get on and donate now. That all being said, this is what I'm talking about today. This is what we call our flagship talk. So it's planning's cheat codes. And for the conference today, it's been updated. It's been updated with everything new that's coming forward, everything that we know that's coming forward. So stand by for information, because it's going to come thick and fast. A little bit on me, just because it's the done thing. 18 years worth of experience now. Chartered town planner. I have a weird set of initials after my name. It means I've done 2 degrees and I've become a member of the Royal Town Planning Institute. I was elected a member of the RTPI in 2006. So I have done my time. I'm an active planning consultant, 30 odd cases on at the moment, with more being added every day. I teach planning with Property Education Partners. I write for YPN, amongst other publications. I run something called Property Expert Network Online, which is our own take on property networking. And I'm doing some development, not much, some small stuff. A barracks building in Wales that's 47,000 square feet. Derelict gatehouse in Plymouth, which was built in 1857, and a grade 2 listed care home being converted to 17 flats. Small stuff, not big. If you want to get hold of me, there are two slides that will help you do that. This one, and it will come at the end as well. And because this is being recorded and on Facebook and everything else, you can catch up with us at tpexpert.org, and you can find everything that we're doing, including the Anti-Guru web series on YouTube and the Planning Game podcast, both of which I present. I'm very lucky, because behind every good town planner is a team of frankly amazing town planners. And I have an amazing team. Now, regrettably, as with every small business at the moment, some of those guys are furloughed. But it's a professional team of 8 with about 100 years between us all in town planning. So we've been there and done that. And our most senior town planner, Keith Oliver, my co-director, has been in the game in excess of 40 years now. So that's the level of experience we bring. And all of our seniors are chartered town planners. Our juniors are going through the process of becoming chartered town planners. We very much believe in investing in people. Right. So some myths I'm going to take away right now. I can't make the planning system go away. There's no magic fix. The only way to revolutionize planning is to give you as developers lots and lots and lots and lots of lovely permitted development allowances. There is no magic bullet. There's no trick. It's just the law. And that's what I'm going to be talking about. How the law is expressed as of here and now. The other thing, for those of you watching in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, is that this presentation can only ever relate to England. That's because of devolution. Now the devolved authorities have got their own planning systems, as it were. They can define their own permitted development rights. So sorry, the Scottish, the Welsh and the Northern Irish, you're going to have to go and look up your own general permitted development order. We do work in Wales at the moment, and I'm learning Welsh. I'm learning Welsh planning. I won't learn Scottish planning because it's just too different. I have no idea what the Northern Irish are doing most of the time. So tonight, this afternoon, I'm going to use some actual examples based on real world experience. None of this is theoretical. As you could probably tell already, I'm presenting at the speed of light. That's because I've got to catch up from Nick going out of date, out of time. He's always going out of time, so that's just standard. And there's a lot to squeeze in. So ask for the slides. That would be a good positive career move. I can't squeeze everything I know into the hour that we've got together. So this is just a few ideas to get you going. and I will swear liberally, I have planning-induced Tourette's syndrome, and in reality, it's fine. It's a good way of me blowing off some steam. So, permitted development for victory. This is our model for assessing planning applications and planning propositions. And this is where permitted development fits inside the model. So victory stands for verify, intelligence, comparables, team, options, reality, and you. And permitted development fits neatly into three of those. V for verify, what are you doing? Are you doing something that's allowed by national or local legislation? O for options, do you have an escape plan? Always have more than one. And R, reality, what can the site actually to deliver? Our victory model is something that we're very proud of and something we use to assess our development prospects going forward. So if you fall out of the victory model, then it's not something we're going to support. If you meet the victory model, then it is something we're going to progress through an application. Okay, so some history. We've gone from HMS Victory, a ship built in the early 1800s, to some more history, and let's see where this fits. So way back in 1947, we got the Town and Country Planning Act. Now that did one very important thing, which was nationalize your ability to develop your own land. Now the Planning Act is important because it includes, amongst other things, the description of development. It includes, amongst other things, the rights and responsibilities of a planning authority. But more importantly, it created a bit of a paradox because there were lots of little developments that could go on that weren't being allowed to happen because of the Town and Country Planning Act, because it includes the definition of development, which is a massive catch-all. Any development under, over, on the land, any material change of use, and any other works carried out by a builder. And that definition has been with us ever since. It's in the 1990 Act. And so you've got this overriding definition driving things forward. Move on a little bit of time to 2015. That's where we have our current general permitted development order. Now, the GPDO does an important and very simple thing. It grants planning permission, because the only way around planning permission is to grant a planning permission. Very, very simply. And that's the order that we refer to today. Now, that order has been amended about seven times since the 2015 order was released, and will probably be amended again this year at least three or four times. We've already had amendments as a result of the COVID bill. So you have to watch for the amendments. Alongside all of this, we have the use classes order, which gives us the use classes, A1, A2, A3, through A5, etc. If you're an HMO landlord, you live in C4. If you're an office operator, you live in B1A. Every use falls in a class unless it's sui generis, which means to himself, to themselves, to ourselves, Latin, of course, and describes uses that don't fall neatly. So large HMOs and the new sort of resurgence of serviced accommodation being a sui generis use falling into that SG category. I know there are many people who debate that, but some current sentiment is that's where most serviced accommodation falls. So this is where we were going from that the Victory built around about the same time, early 1800s. And this is Holborn Viaduct in central London, a whole rigmarole of uses going on here, unplanned development, mixture of styles, mixed use. We love a bit of mixed use today. Planning tends to go around in circles, so it's like fashion. It comes around and comes around and comes around. And hopefully one day I too will be fashionable again. And this is what they were going to. This is 1950s planning in overdrive. This is not a suburb of Chicago, ladies and gentlemen. This is Milton Keynes. Now, this was a planner's idea of heaven in the 1950s. A beautifully designed, beautifully planned, long boulevards, fast roads. It's no wonder that most of the F1 teams are based in or around Milton Keynes. It's 70 miles an hour between roundabouts. So, and everything ordered. Central business district, railway station where you expect it to be, some weird transplanted football team from South East London, and residential organized in orderly districts around the outside. Now, planning is not one system. It's a sequence of systems that have been bolted together over time. And your typical planning department reflects this. Just to nip through them very quickly, you have the policy planners here writing the rules, because planning is a rules-based system. We love following rules in planning law. That's half of what we do. You have a strategy planner, the head of service. They're weirdly the ones that provide an interpreter between these two people, and they are the ones that define the personality of the planning department. They're the head. Now, personality in planning departments is actually quite big. Everyone says that planning authorities like Hillingdon and Three Rivers have a very odd personality. They hate developers. They think you're all nasty. But that is the personality of the planning authority. And sometimes to get to our O for options, we have to think about PD. Development management is where all your applications go. These are the mechanics. They make the system work. Regeneration holds grant funding. Heritage and tree preservation officers make sure that anything you do to a listed building isn't bad. I absolutely love our heritage officers at the moment. They're great. And enforcement officers are there as the planning police force for when things go wrong. Now, permitted development. As I said, it's not an immunity from planning permission. It's a planning permission granted in its own right unilaterally by a development order. It's granted in England. And it is a deemed planning permission. The Secretary of State gets its power from Section 57(3) of the Town and Country Planning Act. Various uses have very different allowances. Now, you cannot read one permitted development order and make an assumption that every right is going to be the same. You can't read individual rights and make that assumption. You have to read them individually. It can involve building work, as I'm going to show you, and it can most definitely involve a material change of use. And most of the commercial conversions I'm going to show you this afternoon do cover that. Now, there are some restrictions, but as I said, these don't apply everywhere. Generally, national parks, conservation areas, listed buildings, SSSIs have their rights removed. However, those are specific to the individual rights in question. You have to read the rights, because no one permitted development allowance is similar to another. They are all worded subtly differently. Councils can remove those rights through an Article 4 direction, and we know of about 20 authorities at the moment that have removed the office to resi PD right, and there are something like 50 authorities now that have removed your HMO permitted development rights. So they do it when they feel they need to. And councils can remove rights on property through planning conditions. That's something we do heavy history checking on now, because they do have a habit of creeping up, even on the most diligent of planning consultants. PD is important because of what's called the fallback position. Now, permitted development is a legitimate fallback position. It's where you can do something anyway. Now, I'm going to show you a couple of examples, certainly in the back end of this presentation, where fallback was used. But the important point here is that the extant permission, the fallback, has to represent a realistic answer. And you cannot deviate too much from that flight plan. You have to be able to demonstrate that you are actually going to do what you said you were going to do on the fallback. So, there are some differences. I was once asked the question repeatedly on Facebook. The guy literally wasn't taking the answer, which is, what is the difference between permitted development and prior notification? And the answer at the very base level is nothing. They are both permitted development rights. The important thing that you have to recognize, ladies and gentlemen, is that a straight permitted development right does not require you to notify the council. You just get on with what you want to do. Building regs being applied for, of course, but in reality, you don't need to tell planning. It is often better, however, to do so because it gives you the piece of paper and the assurance. A prior notification permitted development right includes within it a condition that requires you to make the prior notification application. And the examples I'm going to go through this afternoon, I'll give you as much details as possible on what you need to do at every given stage. So this doesn't require the notification, but it's good to do so. This does require the notification before you change the use. So before you do anything. Now, finally, I suppose we better actually deal with the knotty subject of what actually is a change of use. Now, changes of use relate to what are called material changes of use. And really, what we're getting to here is section 56B. If the development consists of a change of use at the time when the new use is instituted, i.e. when that new use starts. I'm dealing with a case with Matt Baker. And have been doing so for a long time up in Stockport. And the council argued that Matt had run out of time on his prior approval because the new use hadn't started. Well, that's fine because we'll just reapply for his prior approval because the new use has not started. He'd formed flats but not occupied them. And the council have just reapproved that prior approval because the new use has not started. He hadn't actually occupied the flats yet. That was the trigger that they were using. Right. I hope everyone is still awake and alive because that's always kind of important. But we're now going to move on to permitted development allowances for houses, not flats, HMOs and large HMOs, but definitely not flats. And that's because flats do not have permitted development rights. So many times am I asked, I want to do a loft conversion on a flat, is it PD? The answer to that is no. The law makes clear that the rights only apply to houses, HMOs and large HMOs, but definitely not where they are subdivided into flats. So Class A to E of Part 1, Schedule 2, and sorry, I do rattle off legislation as if it's Shakespeare. That's just because I've done 18 years of my life in this, and in reality, it does get under your skin a little bit. Allow for extensions, roof alterations, Velux windows, porches and outbuildings, etc. On the right type of building, you can extend quite significantly. Now, this is a buffet menu, not a la carte. You don't have to just select one. You can select all. And if you choose to select all, you can do so on the right type of building. Now, it is right and fair to say that we have done this. And when I say nothing I'm about to say is theoretical, I think there's actually only one thing that I haven't done. But that being said, I'm going to show you a property we call the mutant. And it looks like this. So this property started life as a two-storey mid-terrace Victorian house. Now the client wanted to get to an eight-bedroom HMO. There wasn't that much room in the back for extensions. He could do a roof alteration, some windows and doors in the front. He could utilise the semi-basement and dig down. And he could realign the interior of the building. So that's exactly what he did. Now, I'm not going to say for an instant that this building looks pretty. It doesn't. But that's not what permitted development is there to do. Permitted development is there to, well, I think the term in this case is cock up buildings in new and innovative ways. But what we got here was effectively a permitted development solution for turning a two-story Victorian home into a four-story modern home. And then, of course, applying for planning permission to change its use. That's because this property went to eight bedrooms sui generis. Article 4 was irrelevant here. Now, it's fair to say that this proposal did not make my client any friends at the council. It is also fair to say that every councillor tried to find a way to otherwise suggest that what had happened was not permitted development. It's very fair to say that the city solicitor at the council in question had to, in committee, advise the committee that there was absolutely nothing that the council could do to prevent this. It was PD and the full extent of permitted development. And that full extent applies today. If it wasn't in a conservation area, he could do the roofs. It was in that kind of non-conservation area, roof. External windows, no Article 4 control there. New door, new floors throughout. Building regs, really heavily involved. 2.3 meter floor to ceiling heights, absolutely bang on with the national standards and the HHSRS. Not great, but PD. Now, I suppose what you're all wanting to listen out for is the commercial conversions part. And I'll go into as much detail as time allows for, but I'm going to try and cover every single part I possibly can. Now, again, with commercial conversions, there are two phases to this. There's the permitted development part and the prior approval part, and they're all found within part three of schedule two of the GPDO 2015 as amended. There have been amendments. So class A, G and L are your non-prior approval rights. Now, if you don't have an Article 4, you can do all of this. Class A allows for the change of use of a restaurant takeaway to a shop or an estate agency. Now, that doesn't sound that disco until you start building in other stuff. Class G allows for the conversion of up to two flats above a shop or an estate agent, solicitor's office, bank, building society, etc. Now, this is one that we've had approved on the screen. This is Reading. Reading is one of the toughest authorities in the country, and where both Article 4 controls on HMOs and the need for affordable housing on one unit and above mean that permitted development is actually a vital part of what goes on there. Here we got prior approval for two flats above a retained post office, and then the client just developed one nice maisonette out of it. That was prior approval. If he wasn't in an Article 4 area, we would have advised him to carry on and go for Class L, house to HMO and back again. That's the permitted development right that allows you to get a house and convert it into an up to six person HMO. That one approved. Now, Class G, two flats above a shop, is frankly amazing because it's the most open of all of the permitted development allowances. There's no restriction on the town centre, no restriction in a conservation area, no restriction on a listed building, and no time code either. You can change use into it and build into it and still utilise it. We've done this to great effect in a couple of locations. We've just finished off one in Northamptonshire where we applied to convert one shop into two. And we did that as an application because we wanted to encompass the first floor in the shop use. And then got a certificate for the conversion of that shop upstairs of that shop into four flats. Because you had two shops. Two shops equals four flats. Two flats above a shop. We've also used it to try and break policy. And the example I want to give here is Queen's Road in Aldershot. Now, Class A used to include pubs. Aldershot had a very, very strong anti-pub conversion policy. But importantly, the council had chosen not to remove the permitted development right, allowed for a shop to go to something else. My client was an estate agent. So that's exactly what we did. We converted the pub to an estate agency under a Class A permitted development right that broke the policy, and then my client could have two flats above his estate agency because that's what Class G allows for. That was all done and dealt with, and then all we had to do was then apply for planning permission to convert the ground floor to another two flats because it was in an estate agency in a residential area, contrary to policy. That one all approved and now completed, and I'm sure you agree, looking rather lovely. Now, the prior approval menu for new dwellings looks a bit like this. Now, I've thrown Class PA in red for very good reason, okay? And I'll come to that when we get there. I think it's best if I get there when we get there. Class M, N, O, PA, and Q. That's the current list. Class M, M for mother, allows for the change of use of a shop, estate agency, bank, building society, etc., and hot food takeaway to a Class C3 dwelling. The things you have to consider are on the screen. The issues are flood risk, ground contamination, and highway safety. It had to be in use as of the 20th of March 2013. And by in use, I mean in use as a shop or whatever it started off as. On that day, you can't change use into these. You can only use existing properties. You're allowed to convert up to 150 square meters of that shop. If you have to leave a bit behind, then yes, you are permitted to leave a bit behind. You're not allowed to extend, but you are allowed to do demolition. So you're allowed to cut stuff away. And in a recent case that we've dealt with in Portsmouth, that's exactly what we did. You are allowed to do external alterations, but you're importantly not allowed to do this in a conservation area on a listed building. Now it says not on a high street there because the high street provision requires you to retain a viable shop on the ground floor. But again, we've used this permitted development right in other locations where we did just that. And I'll show you an example of that later. The one I've got on the screen's been approved. It was a children's toy shop that went bankrupt, and this got converted to a 5-bedroom flat. That's because once it had been used as a 5-bedroom flat, it could then be used as a 5-bedroom HMO. The class does not remove that right. Now, I did say there was one I haven't done yet, and it's this, Class N, amusement center, arcade, or casino. The issues are roughly the same as Class M, flood risk, ground contamination, and highway safety. Had to be in use as such on the 19th of March 2014. 150 square meter conversion again. You're allowed to alter, not in a conservation area, not in a listed building, not on the high street. Now, the image I show here is an amusement center, and it would be very tempting to go and grab those top two floors. The one thing I'd say, however, is that whilst noise is not an issue for planning, it most definitely is an issue for people who live there. And so a noisy environment like this, and this will get horrendously noisy in the summer, is only ever suitable for tourist accommodation. It shouldn't really be used as main housing unless absolutely necessary. Just be aware of your surroundings when you're doing one of these. Class O, B1A offices to C3 dwellings, is one of the most open of the permitted development rights that we're going to talk about. Your issues are flood risk, ground contamination, highway safety, and noise. You're allowed to convert buildings that were in use as offices on the 29th of May 2013 or earlier and retain that lawful use. You're not allowed to alter and you're not allowed to demolish. You're not allowed to do this on a listed building, but oh boy, are you allowed to touch a conservation area. And I've got one going through in Alton at the moment where we're doing just that, conversion of two stories above at first floor level that are in use as offices inside of a conservation area, you're allowed to do it. Now, there was such a thing as Article 2.5, and that land, those areas lost their protections on the 31st of May of last year. So anything that's saying Article 2.5 now doesn't have any protection, and it's down to the individual councils whether or not to service an Article 4. The building you see on the screen has been approved, 11 flats. And this one was interesting because this is where the council went over its 56-day allowance. And on the appeal, the inspector said nothing other than the council went out of time, I allow the appeal. It was as simple as that. Now, I did say I was going to talk at depth about Class PA, and I'll go through the issues, but I'm also going to give a massive great caveat to this. You have to consider flood risk, ground contamination, highway safety, noise and air quality this time. In use on the 19th of March 2014, but here we are, time limited to the 1st of October 2020, and I'll come back to that. A building now must not exceed 500 square meters, and you're not allowed to chop the building up. You can't chop it into segments. It is the building in question that is measured, not the area. You're not allowed to do it on a listed building, but again, conservation areas are A-OK. It must be completed in 3 years, and you're not allowed to touch buildings on an industrial estate. I'm going to come back to that time limit because we've had a lot of queries very recently, and it always happens when we're coming to the end of a PD cycle on whether or not you can do one of these. Now, I know some people have been saying you can. What I would say is this. It only takes the council to refuse, and then you've lost the right. Because if you think about it this way, if you were to apply for one of these tomorrow, that would take you till the 8 weeks would take you to June of 2020. If they refuse you, and they only have to, you would then have to appeal. Currently, appeals are taking 5 months, and probably longer as a result of COVID. So 5 months on June takes you to November, which is exactly 1 month after the time limit has expired. So there isn't, in our view, and certainly in my professional standing, there isn't enough time now to get one of these safely through the system. The one I'm showing on the screen was approved quite happily. It's in Fareham and got converted to 5 Muse-style houses. This building is a lot bigger because it was a commercial printer's, it expands out at the back. Class Q, agriculture to residential, is one of the most effective ways of getting development in the countryside, in my view. And having just seen an appeal decision on such, it can be preferred to normal development. Your issues are flood risk, ground contamination and highway safety. You had to be in use on the 20th of March 2013. DCLG tells us you're allowed to convert up to 465 square metres, and I'm waiting to see someone contradict DCLG on that one in an appeal. You're allowed to convert up to 3 large or 5 smaller dwellings, but the regulation specifies no more than 5. And you're not allowed to extend, but you are allowed to alter. You're allowed to do quite a lot of alteration, removal of walls and roof to facilitate the conversion. However, you're not allowed to mess with the structure. The building must be structurally sound to take the conversion. Conservation and listed buildings are out of the equation. Now, the one you see before you here, we asked for this building to be knocked down. These are old turkey sheds, definitely an agricultural business. Asked for this one to be knocked down and this one converted to 3 homes. That was at the time when we had 3 as a limit. That was approved by Test Valley District Council in that respect. That included the removal of the roof and replacement with a brand new fiberglass roof and the punching of new holes in the walls to create really nice bespoke houses. Really interesting. Once you've done your prior approval, and you're all happy, you can punch in an application for external alterations. Now, this is an example I'm showing on the screen where we did just that. This was a little garage that was a builder's store, so had a storage use. And when we had storage to residential, we could apply for conversion to residential. That was done. And then we applied for its external alterations, new windows, doors, dormers, lovely, all in a conservation area, and created a really bijou 30 square meter home. Now, the beauty on that is, because the extensions were so minor and effectively to an existing dwelling, or a dwelling that had planning permission, we managed to exempt it from the SIL, the Community Infrastructure Levy. We also didn't pay any affordable housing on this one because it had that planning permission for use as a dwelling. Now, a couple more case studies, if I may, and then we'll finish off on that fallback argument. You can combine permitted development rights together in a scheme of works. And this one over here, 200 Pals, Kingston Road in Portsmouth, was an example of just that. So Class G development above, two flats above the shop, retained a shop at that point. And then two flats below, retain the shop. Now, this is that example where we retained the shop. This was prior to me winning two appeals on this street, where the council tried to retain the shops. That's not what our client wanted, and the inspector ruled that this area was not a key shopping area. That set the standard in Portsmouth for what is and is not a key shopping area, but this got our client four flats and a shop and £500,000 per vend at an auction. That's how much it was sold for. That was approved. This one of our largest Class O approvals, and spawned a second Class O approval, was for 242 flats in this tower block of offices. This building had been derelict for 15 years, hadn't been used for 15 years, but had a use as offices. The use was still alive. That got approved, and then the applicant subsequently used that approval and reapplied for 158, and they're currently building out the 158. That is underway at the moment. I'm really looking forward to seeing that building come back into life in the skyline. That building there, part of Portsmouth City Council's waterfront, was on their hit list for demolition for 15 years. And now it's going to get retained with a brand new clad on the outside for the next 100. Just an example of fallback position to get put this in context, and I did say I'd come back to it. This one, Sky End Lane in Hordle, was an example where we got the prior approval right. Two houses, total of 400 square meters. We then applied for and got a replacement. So we got the two, that was the fallback, and we replaced it with one of equal size, 400 square meters. This site is in the Greenbelt. It's between Lymington and Lynmouth and Christchurch in Dorset, and there is a swathe of greenbelt there that you normally cannot build into, but prior approval gave us the lever, and then planning permission was simply for replacement dwellings of an improved design, and that is what was approved. At some point, after all COVID's done, I will go back to this site. I've been invited to do so, to take some photos, because apparently the whole building looks spectacular. Now, the government loves adding some commercial allowances, and for you guys who are currently struggling with retail and want an option, there is the brand new Class JA, because there really aren't enough letters in the alphabet, that allows you to diversify the high street in order to save it. This class allows you to change use from A1, A2, A5, betting office, payday, loan shop or laundrette, to offices. And that's because serviced offices are big business right now. Well, they were. That is quite interesting. It's a prior approval right. The others are a bit boring. But that's a prior approval right that that could bring some life once the COVID pandemic has run its course through the retail market. That could bring some life back into our high street. Right. Some lessons learned, and then I'm going to talk about the future. We've learned some really important lessons over the course of this. We've had prior approval since about 2012 in this form. The first is this: be really clear on the starting use. We've had cases where the council have said the starting use is not clear, get a certificate of lawful use for it, and that's what we've had to do. There's no point in getting a planning permission per se unless you're applying for a retention, but get the starting use sorted out and be really, really clear on it. Council won't do this for you, and neither will any planning officer, so get that sorted out. You need lots of data from your vendor in order to sort it. Absolutely know the rules. Read the GPDO. Look at the individual class. Don't try and do all of them. Do one. One of the biggest lessons that we've learned from our clients is absolutely just do one of these. Don't try and do all of them, because if you try and do all of them, you're just going to come unstuck with the differences. Learn one really well. One of my favorite phrases, one of my favorite bastardizations, as it were, is from Picasso. Picasso said, learn the rules like a pro, break them like an artist. I changed that slightly. My way of saying it is, to play the game, you have to know the rules. To play the game well, you have to know where to break them, especially if the referee is not looking. And then finally, watch that clock. That Northampton case that I showed you came about because they exceeded their 56 days. The council won't tell you when their time is up. They are now allowed to extend it. There has been case law on it, but they have to ask your permission first. And it's the asking of the permission which is so very vital. Don't be forced into it. If they're going to go out of time, let them go out of time. Best time to submit one of these is when the council is not there. So COVID-19, where most councils are seriously not there, is the best time to be hitting them with one of these. Now I'm going to bring out my crystal ball and look into the future, but it's not really a crystal ball because we don't do that. What I'm going to talk about is the white paper that has just been released. Actually, just been released. It was released in March. That talks about the future and what the government wants to do next. And the government wants to bring you three new permitted development rights by summer. Airspace above commercial buildings, airspace above purpose-built blocks of flats, and demolition of commercial and rebuild as residential. Now, the first two are broadly the same. Take a commercial building, put two stories on top, subject to a character assessment, design assessment, etc., and turn those two stories into flats. Sounds great. The other is take a block of flats and do exactly the same thing. We've had this consulted upon numerous times. We've had consultations on this since 2018. So this is the third time this has been consulted upon. It's been pared back and pared back and pared back, and I think the two stories is where it's going to fall. The final one is demolition of commercial and rebuild. Now, this is a rehash of an idea from 2018, and is very much focused on that removing the need for multiple applications on the same site. So this would take away the need for the external alterations, the shell application, and allow you to wrap it all in one. The beauty with this is it allows you to redesign the building in such a way that you get natural light into the building. It solves what's called the Watford problem, where someone really did apply for planning permission for flats without windows. The other part of PD that is likely to change, and is probably not going to please some people, but c'est la vie, it has been coming, and I did say I wasn't going to mince my words, is we're likely to see the national standards incorporated inside of PD. A requirement that all of the dwellings thereby created should comply with the national standards of the time. I think everyone can see that coming. There have been a proliferation of micro units, and it's that proliferation that has led to the government reacting. I'm going to leave the stream open for questions, and I really welcome your questions if you have any, but there's my contact details if you don't want to, you know, throw any questions out there. Thank you very much for listening to me waffle, and yeah, over to you guys.
Perfect. So we do have a couple of questions come through. So what's the first one? What's your view on going for C4 rather than C3 on a 5-bed HMO?
Right, 5-bed HMO would automatically be C4 anyway. So in
for 7+ people, if that's relevant. Ah,
sui generis. Right, got you. Yeah. So we've always had a stepped approach to HMOs where we can get it into C4 first rather than jump straight to the end use. And the reason why we've always had that stepped approach is simply about jumps. So a 3-bedroom family home, for example, can get to like a 5-bedroom HMO relatively easily. And if there's no Article 4, you can go there straight away. Compare that to a 7-person building. So 3-bedroom family home, average 4 people, 7 person, that's a 3-person jump that the council have to deal with. Whereas a 1 or 2-person jump is less. So we've always taken little steps as a consultancy, and we'll continue to do so rather than risk a big jump and then having to fight an appeal. Does that make sense, Josh?
Yeah, absolutely. Perfect. Speaking again on HMOs, can you change a 4-bed HMO to a 6-bed HMO in an Article 4 area under permitted development?
It's not permitted development. It's not development at all. There would be no material change of use between a 4-bed or 4-person and 6-person HMO, even in an Article 4 area, because there is no material change of use. The Article 4 will control simply the change of use between C3 dwelling and C4 HMO. It will not deal with intensification of HMOs inside of that Article 4 as long as you don't shift classes. So if you're going from 4 to 6, it's not development. Simple as.
All right, spot on, perfect. So we've also got converting a commercial building, D1, converting that into 2 buildings, would that require planning permission?
If it's a straight chop, so you're literally turning a D1 unit into 2 D1 units, if it's all internal and there's no external effect, then arguably it's not development because it falls outside of the definitions in para 55 of the Town or Country Planning Act, dealing with what is and is not development. If there were external works, that's what the planning permission would be for, and undoubtedly the council would want to see what you were doing on the inside as a result. But if it's just internal, an internal slice, then that is not technically development requiring planning permission.
Perfect. And also, so I know you mentioned about the high street. So what classifies as being on the high street? And are the side streets kind of acceptable?
It's a really good question, and one that we struggle with a lot as a profession, because the government, well, instead of calling it high street, what they've used is key shopping area. High street is easier to understand, but they've used the term key shopping area, and what the bloody hell is a key shopping area? There is no definition of that in law. There's no definition period of what one of those is. They just came up with some words. So what we have to make a judgment on is it a shopping destination? Is it a place where people need to go to service a need, right? We've had inspectors go both ways. But what we do for safety is if it is a defined shopping area, so like a local centre, a district centre or a town centre defined in the local plan, then the default position should be right. We're going to try and keep the shop. We're going to try and hold on to that commercial use, because that then satisfies the need in the order to preserve that retail use, to demonstrate that retail use can be preserved. So we always go there first rather than try and argue second, because at the end of the day, planning takes time and our client's time is valuable. And if that client's got it on a bridge, then literally every day costs the money. We need that through quick.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've got another question come through. So what sources or leading texts do you use to find the legal authorities?
A few different places. I use a website called Planning Jungle for quick searches. We use DCP Online, which is Development Control Practice Online, which is reasonably expensive, but we use that. We're RTPI planners, so we have all of the access to the RTPI back catalogue as well. JPL does help, that's Journal of Planning Law. And finally, we use a couple of case law search engines that we have access to that help us get to some of the more interesting stuff.
Perfect. What else do we have? If there is space to create three flats above a shop, would that be permitted development, or is two flats the maximum?
So under G, two flats is the absolute maximum. What you can do is combine G and M. So if it's not a conservation area, you could do two flats on the, and it was a three-story building per se, you could do two flats on the top floor under your G, and then drop down and do some more flats on the next floor down under an M and retain the shop below. The one in Portsmouth that we did. Part of the first floor and roof as the G development, and then we did the rest as the M development.
Yeah. Okay. Do we have anything else? So in terms of the do you have any opinion on the best areas for HMOs in terms of the ROI where there's no Article 4 in place?
Oh, that's a really tough one. It comes down to a number of different factors. So I look at, for example, spare room when I'm looking at comparables between people looking. I mean, many other sites are available. I have to do that BBC thing. But I look at sites like Spare Room to compare what's available and what's not. So how many people are looking compared to how many people are offering. I look at rental returns on Spare Room as well, or other sites. So I look at what the market is floating at. But I think it's very much of a muchness. You can get great rental return or great yield from a variety of different areas. You just have to know the area. And I think actually the critical point there is absolutely knowing the area, because every area is very granular when it comes to HMOs. You have hot parts and cold parts. Even central London, you have hot areas for HMOs and really cold areas for HMOs. I saw one in Dover the other day, and I didn't think Dover was an HMO, viable HMO area. And then I did the checks and it's like, oh, actually, no, there's twice the demand for supply. Okay, Dover. Let's have a look at Dover. Oh, can't hear you, Josh, mate. Do you want to unmute yourself?
Sorry, Alice was just talking to me. So in terms of the biggest opportunity at the moment, what would you say that is under permitted development?
I think offices have matured to a point where everyone knows what to do with them, and even the estate agents know what's going on, so they're a bit of a known quantity. I still maintain retail. I love classes M and G because they're nice and broad. And if you get that right, you know, four or five flats out of one building is a pretty good answer to the question. So that's where I would go, Josh. I would aim at retail, classes M and G, especially if you're starting out in PD and you want to do smaller type development. M and G are the place I think you should be.
Well, perfect. So what else do we have? So in terms of where to read the GPDO, is there some sort of government website?
Yep, gov.uk, and you can also find it on the legislation.gov.uk website. That cracking read. Every once in a while, they do bring out a new one that amalgamates everything that's changed. It's normally every 20 years. So we're expecting a new one soon-ish, maybe.
Okay, perfect. Also, if there, can you convert from commercial to, what's that one? do we have any more? So I think that might be all of the questions answered by the looks of it. Cool. Yeah, perfect. So I'd just like to thank you very much for your time. Everyone's found it really useful, really positive feedback on that. So thank you very much for donating your time to the cause. Hopefully everybody has found that useful. Please up your donations. If you've donated already, that's great. You can donate again. Really raise money for the NHS here. So please just keep on giving, especially if you've enjoyed the talk. You've got extra value from it. Just give another tenner in. What's the worst that could happen? So I'd like to thank you very much, John, and I shall speak to you soon.
And you, Josh. Thank you and Alice for organising this. And yes, donate everyone. Great cause and a great team put this on. See you soon.
Perfect. Thank you very much. See ya.